Tonight on Speed Week, we remember one of the greatest drivers of our time, Rich Vogler.
He was the best racer that we had on the circuit, and a lot of circuits. It's kind of put a different meaning on winning now, because when you race with Rich, and if you were fortunate enough to win, you knew you beat the best.
Is brought to you by Dodge Cars and Trucks. On the street or off the road, it's the new spirit of Dodge. Emotion is a big part of life and of the world of racing. And this past week has been a very emotional one for us here at Speed Week. Our show tonight reflects the entire spectrum of emotion, from the sadness we have felt in the death of Rich Vogler, to the hope that you'll see in the eyes of Darryl Gwynn, to the joy of winning races, races that must go on despite the setbacks and tragedies that are a part of the sport that we love. We begin tonight, as we always do, with a look at what's coming up this weekend. NASCAR's Winston Cup division is at the world's fastest speedway, Talladega, and something interesting and unusual happened there during qualifications on Thursday. Dale Earnhardt won the pole position, his first in over 3 years, the speed 192.513.
Well, that's back as we can go. I don't know. It's getting cooler, and I don't know what everybody else is going to do, but the guys did a good job with the car so far, and we picked up every time we ran, so that's what's important to us.
Dale's speed was nearly 7 miles an hour slower than for the pole in the May race at Talladega because of a smaller restrictor plate and the rear spoiler, which has been bumped up to 30 degrees. NASCAR inspectors were carefully watching for illegal manifolds. Some were reportedly confiscated after qualifying for the Pepsi 400 in Daytona earlier this month. The top 10 qualifiers for tomorrow's Die Hard 500 beside Earnhardt on the pole will be Davey Allison, almost a mile an hour slower than Dale. Row 2, Kyle Petty and Mark Martin. Alan Kulwicki and Rob Moroso start in the third row. Harry Gant and Phil Parsons will go 7th and 8th. Row 5, Bill Elliott and Morgan Shepherd. Ken Schrader, the Daytona 500 pole sitter, starts 24th, and the Pepsi 400 pole sitter, Greg Sachs, will go 38th. The only Rick Hendry car in the top 20 was Jimmy Horton. Darrell Waltrip will not start the Tide machine this weekend. Jimmy will go the entire distance.
Yeah, it's a little bit easier. You know, you set your game plan up for a whole race, you know, instead of having to work to get, you know, get our lap back. So that's what we're gearing up to do, and it seems like the crew is pretty pumped up, and, you know, Rick Hendrick Motorsports and all the people there are hoping we do good.
And speaking of doing well, we can't mention Horton without acknowledging his accomplishment last Saturday at Pocono. He won an unprecedented fifth straight super speedway race in the ARCA AC Spark Plug 150. After starting eighth, Jimmy took the lead from Charlie Glotzback with 12 laps to go and coasted to victory. Unfortunately, Jimmy's super speedway win streak ended earlier today at Talladega. The IMSA GT Series is in Portland this weekend for a race you can see live here on ESPN Sunday afternoon at 4:30. Remember the confusing finish there last year? The checkered flag was waved 3 laps before the scheduled end of the race, with the Jaguar driven by Price Cobb in the lead. On the next lap, Jeff Brabham in the Nissan passed Cobb and took the second checkered flag.
I didn't know what to do, so I radioed in, and my crew said, keep racing, which I'm sure that they told Price to do as well, because he didn't slow down and I didn't slow down. We just carried on as if it didn't happen.
Well, Cobb was eventually declared the winner, but for him it was a shallow victory.
No one won. You know, it should have been ultimately Jeffrey's race if it had gone the right distance. And on the other hand, it should have been our race, because it didn't. Through no one's fault, they threw the flag. No one really got to celebrate that win, and it was unfortunate for everyone.
Since then, IMSA has hired a permanent flagman, and no similar incidents have occurred. While the Nissan Performance Technology team has been dominating things here in America, Mercedes-Benz has been doing likewise over in Europe in the World Sports Prototype Championship. And last weekend was perhaps their most impressive performance since entering the series 3 years ago. Round 5 of the championship got off to a bad start with this wreck, which caused the race to be red flagged. The number 14 Porsche ended up badly damaged against the guardrail, but driver Manuel Reuter walked away unhurt. On the restart, Mercedes held first and second with the Jean-Louis Schlesser Morrill Baldy Silver Arrow recording the victory. The Le Mans winning Jaguar team suffered handling problems from the beginning, and although never a factor for the lead, they did finish fourth and fifth. Nissan isn't as strong in Europe as it is here in the U.S. The team of Julian Bailey and Mark Blundell drove to third, their best finish of the year. It was Mercedes' fourth win this season. They seem well on their way to a second straight prototype championship. The next race will be at the Mercedes home circuit, Nürburgring, on August 19th. We'll have video from that race as well. Another major event is being held this weekend in the Rocky Mountains. The Pikes Peak Hill Climb is the second oldest race in America next to the Indy 500. The annual Race to the Clouds has always challenged drivers to get to the top first without dropping over the edge and falling to the valley thousands of feet below. Our Steve Weiss is standing by with a report on the 68th annual Pikes Peak Hill Climb.
Thanks, Bob. What's missing from this year's hill climb are some of the representatives of the European manufacturers. Peugeot and Audi, for example, have dominated the open or rally class in the last 8 years, but aren't attending Pikes Peak this year. There are, however, no shortage of well-known race drivers. The Unser and Mears families have been tackling this mountain for a long time. Robbie Unser is again piloting his Chevy-powered open-wheeler. He set a track record with it in 1988, one of 30 wins for the Unser family at Pikes Peak.
The mountain's been pretty good to the family, and the family's come here a lot of times, and we've been pretty successful, so there's a lot of expectations, I guess.
Roger Mears Jr. is taking his first crack at Pikes Peak and had a solid qualifying run, but a couple of hundred yards past the finish line, front brake problems landed him in the ditch. He claims the car will be ready for Sunday and says it didn't damage his enthusiasm either.
I'm really sorry this had to happen right off. I was hoping to try to make a clean run my first year up here and not have any problems like this.
Roger Sr.'s luck wasn't much better. His car failed to complete the final qualifying run, but it too will be ready for Sunday's finals.
It's a real unique and very special event, and you know, it always draws me back. I try to get away from it every once in a while for a couple years, but it always draws me back.
Other drivers to watch include Leonard Vachholz defending his stock car title, Jack Flannery looking for his first truck class win, and David Donner, whose brother Bobby was killed in a hill climb earlier this year. David wants to defend his brother's Pikes Peak crown. From top to bottom, it's 12 and a half miles, a climb in elevation from 9,400 feet to better than 14,100. The fastest vehicles will make it there in about 11 minutes. Bob?
Well, thanks, Steve. Let's take a look at the top qualifiers for tomorrow's race. In the open wheel division, David Donner, driving a Lee Dykstra design car, was quickest, followed by Bill Brister and Robbie Unser. In the stock car division, Leonard Vachholz led the way with Bobby Register second. Both are in Ford products. Larry Carnes was third in a Camaro. And in the Pikes Peak Division C, an Eagle Talon Turbo driven by John Crawford was fastest. Shannon Millen second and Rob Peterson third. And we'll be back with more Speed Week in a moment.
Speed Week is brought to you by Quaker State. The big Q is one tough motor oil. And by Dodge Cars and Trucks. On the street or off the road, it's the new spirit of Dodge.
Coming up, are safety changes needed in sprint car racing? And the first interview with Darrell Gwynn.
All in all, I think I'll make it.
Last Saturday night, ESPN's auto racing coverage returned to the site of its very first telecast in September of 1979, the Salem Super Speedway in southern Indiana. Rich Vogler was very much a part of the USAC sprint car circuit 11 years ago, and he continued to be through the years, until tragedy struck within 30 seconds of the checkered flag. After setting a new track record of more than 115 miles an hour in qualifying, Rich let it be known early in the feature this was his night. The night he would turn things around and have a good finish on TV. Jeff Gordon had received a lot of publicity this year, publicity that in previous years Vogler had all to himself. And when Rich passed Gordon for the lead, you knew it would only be mechanical failure that would keep him out of victory lane. Or a crash. A lap and a few feet from the checkered flag, Rich's car made contact with another, sending it into the fourth turn catch fencing and ending a career that included five USAC midget titles and two sprint car championships. Because he was leading at the time, he was declared winner of his last race. The racing community tried to go about its routine business the next day, but couldn't. Bobby Hillen's stock car carried a remembrance, and the spot where Rich was to have begun his first Winston Cup race at Pocono was left open. In Indianapolis, longtime friend and car owner Jonathan Bird was remembering more than just Rich's on-track accomplishments.
the intensity that was on the track was so great that everybody is compared in their driving ability and in their desire to win and their willingness to take the extra risk or chance to Rich Voegler. I mean, he's a standard of comparison that drivers will be measured by for the rest of the history of racing.
Bird and CART president Johnny Capels eulogized Rich at a standing-room-only memorial service Tuesday evening in suburban Indianapolis.
You drove every lap to win. Every single lap you won. You never coasted. You never coasted and collected.
Just one day short of his 40th birthday, Rich Voegler was buried next to his dad Wednesday afternoon near Chicago. He survived by his mother Eleanor, wife Emily, and three sons. And later in our show, a final goodbye to Rich. Well, what about the safety of sprint cars? Are there steps that should be considered to prevent a reoccurrence? Well, here were some thoughts on that as Larry Rice, who's at Indianapolis Raceway Park, preparing for tonight's Saturday Night Thunder telecast. Larry?
Thanks, Bob. We all know that automobile racing is an inherently dangerous sport. We all try very, very hard to make it as absolutely safe as we possibly can. That's why at times like these we ask ourselves questions. Would it have been better if Rich Voegler could have looked in a rearview mirror to see that he had a half-lap lead over the second-place car? Would it have been better if he'd had radio contact with his pit crew and they could have told him of the advantage that he had? Or would it have been better if he'd had on a neck brace or a head strap? We'll look at the pros and cons to these and other safety issues tonight on Saturday Night Thunder.
Thanks, Larry. And the USAC Midgets are the featured attraction on Saturday Night Thunder at 9 o'clock Eastern Time tonight. And the USAC Sprints are back in action at Winchester, Indiana. Three-time series champion Steve Butler will take over the ride vacated by Voegler.
Have you wanted to go someplace special but really had to?
The NHRA is at Sears Point International Raceway in California this weekend for the second of three straight races in the western U.S. Last weekend, the Mopar Mile High Nationals were rain-delayed, with the finals being run on Monday night. Warren Johnson comes into this event second in Pro Stock points behind Jerry Ekman. His opponent here in the finals is Larry Morgan, who's third in points. This is a classic drag race. Morgan in the left lane has a reaction time 48 hundredths of a second better, and that's all he needed. The final stat, 777 to 774. The Castrol Cutlass has its fourth win of the year, but even with the loss, Johnson now has the Pro Stock points lead. The Hawaiian Punch Funny Car, driven by Jim White, is in its second final round appearance of the year. In the right lane is Ed the Ace McCullough, the NHRA Funny Car ET and Speed record holder. This is the fifth time in 11 races he's been in the finals. And now he has his third win of the year. That was assured when White crossed the center line at mid-track. McCullough closes to within 602 points of Funny Car leader John Force. With a win, Joe Amato can pass Gary Ormsby and take over the top fuel points lead. His opponent in the finals is Kenny Bernstein. We told you last week to watch for Kenny, who had great Funny Car success here. This is his first final round appearance since switching over to top fuel. Kenny has the better reaction time, but Amato captures his third straight mile-high title with a 5-10 and now has the division points lead. Last Easter Sunday, Daryl Gwynn, one of drag racing's best-liked and most promising drivers, was paralyzed in a crash during an exhibition run in England. Now, more than 3 months later, the 28-year-old Miami native is trying to put his life back together. Confined, except on weekends, to the Miami Project to cure paralysis, Daryl, along with fiancée Lisa and mom Joan, emerged for the first time since the crash last Tuesday to meet with the news media. First, there was the formal news conference.
Hey, Bob.
But it wasn't long before we knew that despite all he's been through recently, his sense of humor was still there.
If y'all thought I was going to come down here dressed like I'd been hurt, you're crazy.
Daryl remembers everything about those few moments on that Sunday afternoon, moments that will affect him the rest of his life, yet is still able to deal with them philosophically.
I realize, smart enough to realize, that it happens to the best of them. Garlitz, Perdome, Bernstein, everybody. They all go through the tough times, and I was prepared for an accident, as we all have accidents during the course of our life, you know. Things aren't going to be smooth our entire life, and I just didn't realize I'd get beat up this bad.
After the meeting with reporters, Darrell and I went outside where we talked more personally about how he's been able to deal emotionally with what's happened.
Well, obviously, it's been no cakewalk, Bob, but at the same time, you know, you cry a little bit and you laugh a whole lot some days, and you laugh a whole lot some days, and you cry a little bit. All in all, I think the support from my family and girlfriend, the fans, the media, have what got me through this more than anything. I have not spent but a couple minutes by myself at a time since the accident, and sooner or later I'm going to have to face myself by myself and do a lot of thinking. And I do a lot of thinking right now, but all in all, I think I'll make it.
If you had it to do all over again, would you sacrifice the wins, the friends that you have made in drag racing to be able to walk again?
I wouldn't change a thing. I was telling Lisa just a week ago that about a month before my accident, I used to drive down the freeway by myself. That's about the only time I had alone. And I told her that I used to think about how happy I was in life and that I wouldn't change a thing. Everything was going good with my racing team, my family life, and my relationship with Lisa. Everything was perfect. I wouldn't have changed a thing. And that was only a month before my accident. So I was obviously at a real good point of real good state of mind. And I had a lot of things going for me at that time.
What do you tell your friends when they ask you what the future for Darrell Glenn holds?
Well, you'll be hearing lots more from me. I'm not going to fade away. This ain't a one-time, how you doing, goodbye press conference. I'm going to be involved with the sport for a long time and hopefully do even more things than I ever did before.
A very brave and wonderful guy, and Darrell hopes to be released from the Miami Project on November 9th. He'll spend weekends at home between now and then, and he can't wait to come to Indianapolis and attend the U.S. Nationals, where he's the defending champion.
One of the best things.
Much of the historic video seen on Speed Week is courtesy of Dick Wallen's Racing Classics.
With the 30th annual Knoxville Nationals a little more than 2 weeks away, many World of Outlaws sprint car drivers saw Wednesday night's race at the Marion County Fairgrounds their last chance to test the half-mile clay before the big show. Rejoining the traveling sprinters was Mark Kinzer back in the cockpit after a crash 5 weeks ago that resulted in a shoulder injury.
The accident, I brushed the wall and I turned sideways and a guy T-boned me and his car got in the cockpit and it broke my shoulder and a rib. And I seen the video and I thought, got hurt and something like that, you know, because it looked so minor and none of the crew thought I was hurt. Nobody turned over or anything. And I flipped a lot harder and not had no more than a couple bruises. So it was one of those freaky accidents.
Mark started in 21st position in the 25-lap feature, led to the green flag by pole sitter Sammy Swindell. The 1983 Knoxville champion led every lap and beat last Saturday night's Kings Royal winner, Doug Wolfgang, by 8 car lengths. Mark Kinzer finished 11th, Steve Kinzer was 4th, and continues to lead the point standings by 235 over Wolfgang. Racing on TV tomorrow at 7:50 a.m. Eastern Time, we'll have live coverage of the Grand Prix of Germany, where the McLarens with Ayrton Senna and Gerhard Berger on the front row, and the Ferraris of Alain Prost and Nigel Mansell in the second row. Sunday afternoon at 1 o'clock Eastern, CBS will televise the Die Hard 500 Winston Cup race from Talladega Super Speedway in Alabama. And Sunday afternoon at 4:30 Eastern, live from Portland International Raceway, we'll have the G.I. Joe's Camel Grand Prix IMSA race.
Speed Week has been brought to you by Quakerstate. The Big Q is one tough motor oil. And by Budweiser, the king of beers. Remember, know when to say when.
ESPN Auto Racing, from coverage of 4 events in 1979 to over 230 in 1990. If you've been with us for the past 11 years, you know how much a part of our auto racing coverage Rich Vogler was. He was, without doubt, the winningest and most talked about driver down through the years.
Well, he's gone now, but left an indelible impression on us, on the sport, and on everyone who knew him. We end tonight's program with our final tribute. To you, Rich, knowing that you would want the show to go on. Could there be any doubt about what little Richie Vogler would do someday? Born into a racing family on July 26, 1950, he watched his dad, Don, win midget races near their Chicago home. And he dreamed about the day when he would wear a real helmet and carry the checkered flag. Rich, cars, and speed were a natural combination. It wasn't long before Rich began to realize his dream of being a winner, first in quarter midgets at the tender age of 9. When he moved to full-size midgets, he drove and won in his dad's car with the number 9 on it. Funny, but when his dad drove the car, it was number 29, and victories were harder to come by. He became the United States Auto Club's second winningest driver in history. Only A.J. Foyt had more. His first and a Harry Turner-owned midget at Angel Park Speedway in Wisconsin in August of 1972. He and his father continued to race against each other until Don was tragically killed at the Indianapolis Speedrome in 1981. The young Rich Vogler was willing to try anything. Anything that went fast. Anything he could win with. He took that attitude with him. And he left us with some of the best memories that a race fan can ask for.
Semi-feature, feature event, you know, even qualifications is a race, and I go out there to win every race that I enter.
Keep going to the races, Rich, and we'll think of you often. You taught us to never settle for second. You were a winner.